Our next speaker in Borders, Boundaries, Fronteras, Rethinking American Music is Marc Gidal. He is an associate professor of musicology at Ramapo College of New Jersey, a public liberal arts college. He is the author of Spirit Song, Afro-Brazilian Religious Music and Boundaries, which was published by Oxford University Press in 2016, and is currently writing a book about Brazilian jazz in New York City.
All right, wonderful. Thank you, everyone. Congratulations to Professor Susan Thomas and her colleagues and staff and the University of Nebraska Press for launching the new version of this important journal and for hosting this wonderful symposium. My name is Marc Gidal. I'm Associate Professor of Musicology at Ramapo College of New Jersey. I go by Gidal in Brazil, so it's a great boundary play if you call me by both names. To contribute to the journal's inaugural theme of boundaries, borders, and fronteras, my paper examines how musicians have been combining Brazilian samba and U.S. jazz in contemporary New York City. The full article also explains how interpretations of the music differs between the U.S. and Brazil and researchers' relationships to their field sites. Today, I will focus on aspects of the musical fusion that I am calling boundary play. Brazilian jazz is an umbrella term that is called instrumental Brazilian music in Brazil and can be compared to fusions of jazz with other genres and traditions, especially Latin jazz, and examples around the world glossed as ethnic jazz, world fusion, and so on. Latin jazz usually refers to fusions of US jazz with Afro-Hispanic Caribbean music, often developed both in the Caribbean and in the mainland US. Although Brazilian jazz has also been considered a substyle of Latin jazz, when Latin jazz is more broadly defined as fusions of Latin American music and US jazz. I use the phrase Brazilian jazz fusion sometimes when pointing out various combinations without necessarily calling Brazilian jazz a genre. Bossa nova, which combines samba, jazz, and European art music, is the most famous Brazilian jazz fusion, and most histories of Brazilian jazz include it as a key development during the 1950s and 1960s. Samba jazz, you following all this?
Yeah.
Got it? There's a quiz at the end. Samba jazz, a related, overlapping, and at times synonymous term with bossa nova, often refers to instrumental music and more improvisatory renditions of bossa nova songs and other song repertoires, usually played at faster tempos. Okay, with that in mind, in 2015, a concert at Carnegie Hall celebrated the 50th anniversary of Rio 65 Trio, an influential album of samba jazz by Afro-Brazilian pianist Dom Salvador, bassist Sergio Barroso, and drummer Edison Machado, recorded in Rio de Janeiro. Salvador has been a fixture in New York City's Brazilian jazz scene since the 1970s. Substituting for the deceased Machado was drummer Duduca da Fonseca.
Substituting for Machado was Duduca da Fonseca, who's also been living in New York as long as Salvador since the 1970s. The original album typified the small ensembles clustered in Rio de Janeiro and Sao Paulo, mostly trios of piano, bass, and drums, whose members mixed samba and jazz during the 1960s. One of the main reasons that Salvador, da Fonseca, and other Brazilian musicians moved to the US was because of their love of North American jazz, rather than an exclusive commitment to Brazilian music and Brazilian nationalism, or to flee the military dictatorship. Salvador told me, quote, "Always I had in mind to come to the United States to really listen to my heroes. I always liked American jazz, you know, the real thing." He wanted to learn, quote, "the American way to play jazz," unquote. So he would listen to professionals in New York nightclubs. It took him a long time to play with what he described as an authentic North American jazz, quote, spirit. Salvador has been playing his composition Gafieira since 1982. He combined influences from the gafiera, a style of samba played in urban dance bands, with Brazil and Brazil since the 1940s with up-tempo bebop style jazz, resulting in a fast-paced, challenging tune for improvisers and accompanists. His recorded performances serve as my musical examples to show different aspects of musical fusion between samba and jazz and what I'm calling boundary play. First, musical fusion can be explained as symbolic work, boundary work, which I am calling boundary play for its creative artistic implications. Second, boundary play can encompass a range of musical interpretations between and within categories and depends on musicians' multiple competencies. Third, and you're gonna have to pick up the journal article to read this, the different settings for musical fusions can influence interpretations of boundary play, even if the music is the same or similar. Specifically, interpretations of Brazilian jazz in Brazil can differ from Brazilian jazz in the US, or interpretations thereof. Fourth, the awareness and interpretation of boundary play and musical fusion can depend on the relationships of musicians, audiences, and also scholars to the field, including myself.
Music scholars regularly address fusion and boundaries together because fusion implies combinations of musical elements and practices whose distinctions help define categorical boundaries, musical or extramusical. We could frame creative acts of musical fusion and discourses about them through the social science using the social science concept of symbolic boundary work in the sense that it expresses it, they can express and bridge differences. So to juxtapose the terms musical fusion and boundary work might sound to you all like it's combining opposite intentions. The former implies mixture and the latter separation. However, studies of symbolic boundary work treat both tendencies. So we might say boundary awareness can happen during boundary crossing activities that may produce fusions, as well as boundary maintenance acts that may favors separation or favor authenticity. To adjust the sociological terms for music studies, the work in boundary work might be better stated in creative artistic terms as practice, process, performance, or play. To this end, I suggest that boundary play suits the variety of boundary conscious fusing activities that musicians use and that audiences, critics, and scholars interpret. I use play in a very broad sense to embrace playing music, creative play, and social play in relation to the identity, culture, and society. In short, musical fusion features playful mediations of symbolic and social boundaries. Now to the music. So here's Gaffieira, just the melody. Analyzing Dom Salvador's tune, Salvador, Gaffieira, the melody we just heard has three phrases. I'm labeling these A, B, and C. Each is repeated twice to produce this form, which is repeated for improvisations. Figure one shows the initial melody of the A phrase played after a complicated introduction. The A phrase evokes an older dance band and it's rhythmically characteristic of samba with the 16th note based accenting and anticipated beats set in 2/4 meter. Okay. The combination of samba and jazz is smooth enough that U.S. critics recognize and appreciate the familiar speed, the riff-based melody, syncopations, anticipations, and polyrhythmic texture. So Salvador's compositional boundary play was to create combination of samba and jazz. This was his intention and the result. And I quote from the critics in the volume. You're gonna have to trust me on that one. Yeah. Figure two, samba jazz drumming shows fusions of the parent genres as well as a history of innovations and room for nuanced play. Da Fonseca was inspired by Salvador's original collaborator, Edison Machado, as well as American drummers Elvin Jones, Paul Motion, and others. Da Fonseca's samba jazz groove resembles the sound and approach of modern jazz drumming by combining aspects of samba and swing-based jazz. He explained how he translates Brazilian grooves from percussion to drum set in his instructional book, co-authored by Bob Wiener. Figure two shows a basic drum pattern modeled on an exercise in the book, which is similar to what they play on the album. Let's hear it.
One, two, one, two.
Okay, the bass drum below the bottom line of the stave establishes the on-beats and pick-up 16th notes, a signature feature of samba that mimics the large one. Surdo drums of the samba schools. That's the part going doom da doom da doom da doom da doom. The hi-hat, the lowest line, plays 8th note off-beats, which coincide with the backbeat in African American music, although at times Da Fonseca plays on-beats on the hi-hat, so like one. Da Fonseca often transfers rhythms typical of the small tambourine frame drum from samba ensembles to the ride cymbal above the top line, and sometimes to the snare drum in middle space. The tambourine pattern is structurally central in samba. For example, Salvador's A section melody represents this too. You heard a da 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 da. The result is that although Da Fonseca is playing an identifiable rhythms from Brazilian genres, the overall sound shares basic qualities of jazz drumming. The ride cymbal maintains the fastest pulses, even though the rhythms are derived from samba. The bass drum and hi-hat establish the downbeats and upbeats in metric time. Tom drums are used for fills and alternative patterns and timbres. And the snare drum, bass drum, and crash cymbals are used to respond interactively with other musicians. You could say the same thing of standard Latin jazz drumming for drum set as well. This fusion has a syncretic quality, I argue, where commonalities can be interpreted differently depending on the listener's orientation and knowledge of the styles. People hear it differently depending on their background knowledge. An area of more noticeable stylistic differences can be found in improvisations when soloists play rhythms and swing feels either from samba or from jazz. This also shows a concept that the Brazilian musician musicologist Acacio Tadeo de Camargo Piedade has advanced, that Brazilian jazz has, quote, a friction of musicalities rather than common or translated musical elements. There are different conventions of swing in Brazilian music than there are in North American jazz. If a succession of 4/8 notes is played in the North American swing field, the notes might be played long, short, long, short, long, short, like one and two and one and two and one. If a succession of 4/16 notes is played with a swing feel of samba, they might be played with a progression of long, short, medium, long durations. Da, 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 one, e, and a, two, e, and a, one, e, and a, two, e, and a. Musicians play with these poles in myriad ways and degrees, depending on the musician's competencies in either genre, as well as the ensemble, the piece of music, the tempo, and other factors. Consider Laura Dreyer's alto saxophone solo on Don Salvador's 2010 recording of Gafieira. Dreyer had been playing with Salvador since 1992, after studying Brazilian music and playing in Brazilian bands in New York. Her improvisation She uses, in her improvisation, uses mostly syncopated 16th notes, rhythms, and timings conventional to samba and playing on the beat. She takes great pride in her hard-earned competency playing Brazilian music in this manner. At moments during her solo, she also plays 16th note phrases with a light intensity of jazz swing feel that remind her of jazz funk fusion, specifically Tower of Power. Okay, figure three shows a transcription of four measures in the middle of her solo. Let's listen. And figure four charts the microtiming durations of each note measured as percentages of equal duration notes or quantized 16th notes. The measurements in figure four indicate the jazz swing pattern of long, short note durations in the second part of the phrase. During Dreyer's solo are moments of friction between the two swing feels in an otherwise rhythmically synchronized texture. By the way, musicians in New York from Brazil and elsewhere also move between these two swing feels. It's not that just because she's a North American player. Let's listen. So, were these moments of play between the two genres intentional? And how did musicians interpret such moments of musical frictions rather than overlapping similarities? When I showed Dreyer evidence of the jazz swing in her solo, she was taken back at first. Quote, "You can take me out of jazz, but I'm still a jazz musician." She then pointed out, though, quote, "It's a much smaller duration than in jazz," and reasserted her point that about playing Brazilian music on the beat and not dragging. Quote, "The most important thing is staying on top of the beat. So within the beat, yeah, there's a little wiggle room for phrasing and inflection and stuff like that, but where you put the beat has to be right with the bass drum." Dreyer seemed a little defensive about her use of jazz swing and phrasing in samba jazz groove, which was, to be sure, a very brief moment in her solo. On the other hand, Dom Salvador appreciates that she intersperses bebop and samba styles, each with high levels of competency. He told me, yeah, that's what I like, bebop. She puts bebop in. I remember Michael Cascuna. I sent it to Michael Cascuna. He's a record producer from Blue Note Records. I remember I sent him the album, and the first thing he said to me was, "Who's that playing?" He had never heard Laura play. "My gosh," he said, "she really plays bebop and samba." He laughed. I said, "Yes, I've been playing with Laura for more than 20 years in different situations. From the beginning, she was very interested in Brazilian music, a lot. She likes Brazilian music. She's got it, the way, the 2-4. She's got it, how to read with a Brazilian accent." Dreyer spoke similarly of Salvador's multiple competencies and their relationship, and I quote her in the published article. "Their comments and rapport show the acceptance of flexible boundary play. They embrace moving back and forth across stylistic boundaries, sometimes alternating their distinctive elements, while at other moments and in other ways, combining aspects and emphasizing their commonalities." The predominant boundary play in this article happens when musicians create musical fusions by commingling conventional stylistic elements of two iconic genres from Brazil and the US. They create a metaphorical common ground where musical elements can be interpreted through the lenses of multiple genres. How music and observers define and judge such commingling of musical elements is also subjective and contextual. In the full article, I explore how interpretations relate to national settings, the subjective perspectives of scholars. Thank you very much. Questions, comments, concerns? Yes.
Could you go back to the slide that had a really difficult to read chart.
No, no, I'm sorry. You have to buy the journal. This one?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So explain what I'm doing here.
Yeah,
so one of the things I'm doing in my research is analyzing, comparing swing feels, and this is a bit of that. And in order to do that, I bring the music into Sonic Visualizer and map out where all the micro timings and export it and bring it into Excel and then I create a lot of charts. I have a lot of charts in my research. And what this helps me do is rather than just using my ear to try to transcribe, you know, what's going on and decide what's happening within each of these notes, I can actually see when are they using jazz swing and when are they using Brazilian swing? This kind of pattern. This is this is consistent with the literature on Brazilian swing. It looks like this, and this is consistent with jazz swing. So by doing this kind of analysis, I'm able to sort of pinpoint moments. And then I would add, and then I bring that back to some of the musicians like Laura and have feedback interviews where we listen to music and I show them charts. And they've been very productive for refining, not just getting feedback, but refining what I'm doing, the process too.
You're kind of quantifying
yes.
how they play and then showing them and seeing what their reaction is.
Yeah. I mean, that's not the only, I don't always go back and do feedback interviews, but yes, a lot of analysis of that. Yes. Sorry. Any other questions? Yes. Hi.
This is really great music and cool research. I guess one question I had, especially with that quantized section that you pulled out, is do you think about other explanations for why notes might be different lengths? Like maybe there's a technical
yes.
reason on the saxophone, or maybe like
yeah.
this, you know, she's rushing to get to like the next downbeat, or I don't know, like.
Yeah, I also have looked at accenting patterns. Instrumentation is another factor. Those are the two big ones that come to mind immediately, and I've done some comparison of those too. More so with the samba jazz stuff. Like, what kind of? I'll show you a quick. More so like with Duduca da Fonseca's playing, depending on what pattern he actually plays influences the swing. Or what instrument he's playing it on changes the amount of swing. Or the tempo is a big deal too. So yeah, I use all of that as well. But it just, here I was just touching on it slightly.
Yeah.
But it's a bigger picture, bigger thing. Or the patterns, if they're basing it on a tambourine pattern, that creates a kind of a slightly different swing. But it rarely contradicts this general pattern. What will happen is these bars will be slightly different sizes. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much.